Hi everyone, we'll wait just a minute here for all of our participants to be logged into the webinar and then we'll get started. So just hang tight with us here for a little bit. Everyone, we'll just wait a few more seconds just for the rest of our participants to be logged into the webinar and we'll get started. So bear with us just for a little bit. All right, we'll go ahead and get started. Thank you all for joining us for today's From the Field webinar series, which we will be conducting with some of our partners from Louisiana Department of Wildlife and Fisheries. Before we get started, a couple of housekeeping notes to mention. We are recording this webinar and we will post a link on our website in the coming days in case you'd like to share with folks who aren't able to join us today, or if you missed part of it, you can watch the full recording there. If you have questions, please do use the Q&A function to post your question to us, and we will try to get to all the questions by the end of the presentation. You can submit Q&A questions anytime during the presentation as well. Thank you to our anonymous sponsor for today's webinar. Our webinar has been sponsored in memory of Kate Mars, who is a longtime friend and supporter of the International Crane Foundation. We are very appreciative of the sponsorship. And to learn more about sponsoring one of our webinars, please feel free to contact Kate Fitzwilliams at the number on the screen or at kate@savingcranes.org. So today we will be talking to you about our unique ways to raise and release whooping cranes into the wild. A quick intro for our presenters today. My name is Hillary Thompson. I work at the International Crane Foundation in our North America program. And I work mostly with the eastern migratory population of whooping cranes, which has been reintroduced into the eastern US. And I work with the cranes after they've been released and once they're in the wild.
Hi, I'm Marianne Wellington, and I'm ICF's, I also work at the International Crane Foundation. I'm a chick rearing supervisor, and I work with the captive flock.
Hi, I'm Eva Szyszkoski. I work with the Louisiana Department of Wildlife and Fisheries on the non-migratory reintroduction project here in Louisiana. But prior to this, I also worked with the International Crane Foundation on the eastern migratory population.
So today we're going to be talking to you about whooping cranes, which is one of the two species of cranes we have here in North America. Whooping cranes are about 5 feet tall. They're all white with a little bit of black on their face and some black wingtips, a little bit of red on their head, like the adult you can see in this photo on the left. And their chicks are this kind of cinnamon brown color that get more white as they get older. And this is a wild hatch chick here in Wisconsin. So our ultimate goal is to have adult birds in the landscape, both in our reintroduced migratory and non-migratory populations that are hatching and raising chicks in the wild on their own. So this is kind of our ultimate goal for this population. So historically, whooping cranes were pretty widespread across North America. They lived in the areas in green on this map. They lived in wetlands, so they are a wetland-dependent bird. They were never as common as sandhill cranes are. Since sandhill cranes use more upland areas, they're not as tied to the wetlands and have a little bit broader use of habitat. Historically, there were both migratory and non-migratory populations, including a non-migratory population in Louisiana. And in the 1940s, the population size of whooping cranes throughout their range went through a pretty low bottleneck. So there was only about a couple dozen whooping cranes left in the wild that were migrating from Wood Buffalo National Park in Canada down to the Aransas National Wildlife Refuge on the Texas Gulf Coast. And that population still exists today and is known as the Aransas Wood Buffalo population. That's that kind of longest arrow with the gray ends on the map. Since that time, whooping cranes were listed as an endangered species, and there have been lots of different types of actions taken to protect the species in the wild, including the starting of a captive breeding program and having adult captive birds that are sort of a safeguard for the species in case something were to happen to the populations in the wild. And those birds were also used to breed juveniles in captivity for reintroduction into historic areas, including the Grays Lake population, which was the first reintroduction effort out in the American West, the orange circles and arrow. And in that population, whooping crane eggs were put in the nest of sandhill cranes and learned to migrate from the sandhill cranes. And then after that, there was the Florida non-migratory population in the purple circle down in Florida. Then the eastern migratory population, which is the population I work in, where whooping cranes breed in Wisconsin and winter down in the southeastern US, the black circles on the map. And then our most recent reintroduction effort has been the Louisiana non-migratory population, the yellow circle in the map that has been reintroduced in part of that historic range where there was a non-migratory population before. So our ultimate goal is to downlist the species. And downlisting just means that we want to take the whooping crane from the endangered species down to being maybe a threatened or eventually a species of least concern is the ultimate goal. But the first step is getting them downlisted from endangered to threatened. And to do that, there's the Whooping Crane Recovery Plan, which was made by the US and Canadian governments, that lists two objectives, and each objective has measurable criteria, different ways we can achieve that objective. The first objective is to establish self-sustaining populations of whooping cranes in the wild that are genetically stable and resilient to environmental offense. So we want the populations to be self-sustaining, where they can live and thrive on their own, where it doesn't require further releases of captive reared birds. We want them to be safe and healthy and growing in the wild. The second objective is to maintain a genetically stable captive population to ensure against the extinction of the species. So if something were to happen to the wild populations, we still have whooping cranes in captivity that will keep the species from going extinct and like I mentioned earlier, also help to produce captive bred birds for release into the wild to bolster some of those populations. So there's a few different ways that we can reach objective one. The first being protect the whooping cranes that are in the wild, the population that has existed through time. And there's also a few different options that include having some reintroduced populations as well. So the bulk of our presentation today will be about how do we get those reintroduced populations to exist in the first place, and what are we doing to have them be successful so they can help reach this objective and eventually downlist the species.
So as Hillary mentioned, there were a couple of objectives to meet, and in the 1960s, it was decided that to visit the wood buffalo nests, and if there were two fertile eggs in the nest, then one would be collected, and that would help bolster a captive population that started out at Patuxent Wildlife Research Center in Maryland. And the other fertile egg would remain in the wild, and there'd be low impact on that flock. As Hillary mentioned, one of the reintroduced populations early started out at Grays Lake, where they took eggs, whooping crane eggs, and put them in sandhill crane nests. This looked great in order to have a second population. The sandhills did most of the work, and they would teach the chicks great habitat to be living in and the migration route. However, as the whooping cranes became of mature age and started looking for mates, even though they were in proximity to other whoopers, they were not interested in them. And so this was the first inkling that we had about imprinting and how that affected cranes, and the fact that we probably wouldn't be able to use cross-fostering for developing a migration route. So in the mid-80s, there was a lot of work on costume rearing, and costume rearing we'll talk about just in a minute or two. So this work was quite successful. The birds had high survival rate and return rates when they were released in Wisconsin. The unfortunate thing with the costume rearing method was that it relied on wild sandhills as guide birds. And there were still lingering concerns about imprinting and connection with sandhills and whooping cranes. So we wanted to postpone using them costume rearing until there was already a flock of whooping cranes out there that we could augment then to. We could also use the costume rearing for non-migratory populations. So in the mid, in the 90s then, how do you go about teaching a crane a new migration route? And so there were a lot of experiments going on. I'm not a pilot, so I'm not going to get into details here about that at all. But I just wanted to let you know that there was a lot of creative thinking going on. And finally, in the late 1990s and then in 2000, what happened is a combination of putting the costume rearing and the ultralight together. And so we had the first ultralight-led costume rearing whooping crane migration by Operation Migration. And that's how most of the eastern migratory population was started. And then the costume rearing could augment that. We talked a little bit about captive centers. And during this time, Patuxent did an excellent job of growing the flock. And in the late 80s, half the flock was split, and so that there were a lot of breeding pairs that went to Calgary Zoo as well as to the International Crane Foundation. Then in 2018, the Patuxent Whooping Crane Project shut down, and with that, then all the birds were dispersed to other zoos who are now going to be involved in captive rearing and hopefully producing it. Eggs and then chicks that can go into our reintroduction programs. At ICF, we have a captive flock, and in order to get more eggs for these reintroduction programs, we recycle the birds. And so when a pair lays, we pull the eggs, and then we have our the rest of our flock act as surrogate incubators, and they incubate the eggs until it's close to hatching, and then we bring them into artificial incubators. And then as we hear the chick and see that the egg is moving, we hear the chick peeping, we'll move it into the hatcher room, which is on the right-hand side, and you can see that the egg is pipped. And once the egg is pipped, it's probably within 24 hours that we will end up having a little chick that we need to take care of. So this, this chick then goes out to our isolation rearing facilities, where it goes into a brooder box, which is an example is on the right-hand side, and you see the brood model with its head in the food bowl. There's a water bowl, and then you can see a heat source in the back. And then the costume is introduced to the chick fairly early on, so the chick knows that it is cared for and interacted with. Costume, you're like, this doesn't really look like a bird. We realize that the main thing is that we're trying to provide imprinting cues to be a white, big white bird. So our body is covered, our human features are covered. And then we have a puppet, which is where we interact with a bird the most. And so if there is a hawk flying over, an airplane flying over, we need to remember to tilt the puppet head to look at it and not our human head. We also use a brood call instead of us using our voices. We talk with a brood call so that it is a real crane call calling, but it sounds very much like a purring, kind of like a cat purring sometimes, more of a and we do take treats with us sometimes. Not all of us are great foragers, and when we're out there earlier in the spring, we don't find as many insects, so we do end up taking treats with us. And of course, these are wetland birds, so we wear our galoshes so that we can go into ponds. We take care on the imprinting process to try to continue to hide our human features. We use decoys when the costume's not around, as well as the brood models. And then you see two costumes have a mesh divider between them. And you see on the right-hand side that two crane chicks are fighting. So it's really important that we raise them individually, and they only go together at recess time or socialization time when they can be well supervised. It's important for us to get the chicks out and in the fresh air. And whenever we're out in the yards, we want to make sure that we can interact with the brood model, with the role model. This is an adult crane. So the chick ends up hearing and seeing this adult crane and how they respond to us as a costume. But also if people would come in or if deer walk by the facility, dogs walk by, then there's also the alarm calls that the chick gets to learn more communication from the real thing. Chicks grow very quickly. They can grow up to an inch a day. They can gain over 20% of their body weight in a day. So it's really important for them to get out and get exercise. When we're working in the costume, we're encouraging them to forage. It's very easy for the cranes to go after spiders and anything that's moving. We also try to teach them to glean seeds when we're out in the field, as well as just encouraging foraging in the ground for various insects. And they do eat different plant tubers, etc. We do have ponds for them, and some birds are quite good foragers. So the bird on the left, it found a frog and ate it. And then the bird on the right, I didn't notice until later that there was this big lump on its neck. Basically, we had been foraging around in an area where there were snails. I didn't offer the snail to the chick, but it decided to eat it on its own. So it was quite startling to watch that go down, but there were no issues with that. Whooping cranes are wetland creatures. So as I've mentioned, we want to provide ponds, and it's very important for them to get out into the ponds early on, make sure that they're water oriented and not that they stay in dry areas because they're in captivity. One of the hardest things for me to do actually is to teach a crane chick to drink out of a bowl. So lots of times we bring out a chick really young into the pond so that they can walk in and drink. And that reduces chances of the chicks becoming dehydrated while we're trying to train them to come to a water bowl. As the chicks get older, we end up socializing them together, which is what you see middle-aged chicks in the middle picture. And then we do take them outside of our fences. And this is one of our marshes here at the International Crane Foundation. And we get them out so they hear different sounds and see different wetland characteristics. Of course, it's very important for the cranes to be able to fly. So we do encourage flight. It's kind of bittersweet. We get really excited and happy about the fact that this individual flew. However, once they fly, they become grounded. And so we keep them in a top covered net, basically for their safety, so that as they're learning to fly, they don't end up flying and trying to land in the pond, and there's the netting between them. And also there's concerns, or not concerns, but there's questions or theories out there about if the birds start flying around and they get up above treetop level, then are they starting to imprint on that habitat, that location? And so we want that to occur wherever they're going to be released. So the crane chicks get wide open views. They do get to see turkeys and deer walking by, possibly even coyotes. And we do encourage them to roost in water, which you notice the birds on the left just don't quite have it and they prefer to laze around on this side. But by the time they're ready to go for release, they are roosting in the middle of the pond. We do health checks on our chicks, and you'll notice these costumes are all gray. Whenever we do negative interactions or stressful interactions with them, we try to do that in a gray costume so that it makes it easier for the white costume that's apparent looking like a whooping crane to interact with them. So the chicks do get weighed and they do get their vaccines, similar to human babies. When it's time to transferred to Louisiana, the gray costume comes in again and we put the bird in the boxes and then we end up transferring them by van and then by airplane. The other means of raising birds in captivity is parent rearing. And parent rearing is starting to be used more and more, and the new zoos partners coming in are going to probably be doing more parent rearing than costume rearing. It mimics very much what happens in the wild, that the adults raise the chicks. It's important for us to give them food bowls and water bowls or access to food and water so that the parent and the chick can be eating and drinking out of the same area. So it's very quick that the chick catches on to finding this balanced nutritional diet. We found out over the years that even though food is provided for the families, the adults quite often spend more time foraging for insects, et cetera, to give to the chicks and don't come to the food bowl except to feed themselves at times. So in order to get the chicks to be eating out of the food bowls and to also help out in case, especially in Wisconsin, sometimes we have colder springs and there's not as many insects out, we help provide treats, and that brings the parents and the chicks over to the food bowls. This is a parent-reared bird down in the Audubon Species Survival Center. And you'll see food and water that both the chicks and the parents can get to. With the new institutions coming on, there's potential for parent-rearing and twinning. We're hoping that by twinning, we can have more birds available for releases into Wisconsin. Twinning is not really twins, but two chicks that are being raised by the parents. It's important to have fairly large enclosures for this, as well as both the male and the female need to be good foragers and good providers in order to feed both of those chicks to fledging age. And of course, we do want to provide ponds or wetlands for parent reared birds as well. Healthcare is also done on the parent reared birds, especially for the first week. We wanna make sure everything is going well. Once we know that things are going well, the chick is growing very quickly, then we end up backing off and only checking on them periodically. As I mentioned before, the chicks grow very quickly. A chick on the left is only about a month and a half old, and you can see it's already half the size of its parent. And the chick on the right-hand side is 3 months old and is pretty close to the same size as the parent. We keep these birds generally in captivity with their parents until they're roughly 4 months old. And then between 4 and 5 months old, we end up releasing them. And Hillary will talk about that a little bit later.
All right, so once the chicks are old enough, it's time for them to be released in their respective regions. Before I go into ways that we release them, I just want to remind everybody, if you have any questions that come up during the presentation, please feel free to submit them in the Q&A section on your screen. So one of the ways that we release cranes into the wild, and what we do in Louisiana, is use these soft release pens. As you can see in the photo, there's a large fenced in pen with a smaller section inside of it. That smaller section has a top net. So when we first get the cranes, they go in there while they get used to their leg bands and kind of get used to the area. And then they get released after a couple of weeks. These pens are placed in remote areas, in the marsh, in areas of good crane habitat. So on the day of release, we go out as the costumes and open up the gate and have all the chicks come out. We do provide them with supplemental food for about a month after their release, just to sort of encourage them to stay around the area as they get used to flying, number one, and just their new habitat. After about a month, we remove the food and they are completely on their own.
For parent-reared whooping cranes that are released in the eastern migratory population, we've mostly done a hard release method where we release one or two juveniles in areas where there are adult cranes. The idea here is that we would like the adults to kind of adopt or foster care the captive-reared juveniles and show them the way, show them how to interact with their habitat, where to find food, where the safe roosting places are, and eventually teach them how to migrate south. So there's a lot of planning and logistics that go into this process so that we release the birds into the best area that we can. So first we look at all the places where there are adult whooping cranes. We try to focus on maybe pairs that have hatched chicks earlier in the year and have lost their chicks. Pairs that might be good parents or be willing to take a young crane under their wing. We also look for places where there's good roosting habitat near good foraging habitat so that if the young cranes don't fly right away, which they haven't really flown yet because they've been in captivity, so we don't want to expect that they'll be able to fly between roosting and foraging areas on their first day out in the wild. So we want to try to have places where their safe roosting habitat is near good areas in which they can forage. So we do site visits, like you can see the picture in the middle. We look at different areas, see if there's an area that we can access with a crane that's in a crate, and if we have permission to release birds there. We also want to release them in areas where they might encounter other young whooping cranes if they return there. So lots of planning before we do the release. But then the actual release is quite quick. We put the cranes in the crates. We bring them out to the release site and we open up the door. So it's all very exciting, and I'm sure the cranes are wondering where the heck they ended up. But we try to put them in the best places that we can. So after we open the door, we hope that they will see the adult cranes in the area. They'll know, hey, that's a whooping crane just like me. I'm gonna go follow them around and hope that they'll let me hang out with them. So you can go to the next slide. After we release them, we hope that what we see will be the juveniles hanging out with the adults. Here's a couple of photos of instances in which our parent-reared juveniles have associated with the foster parents and have migrated south with them, which is really what we want to see.
Now, before all the birds get released, they do receive unique color combination codes and either one or two types of transmitters. There's remote transmitters, of which there's a couple different kinds, but basically those we can sit at our computer and get data points and know where the birds are located. The other transmitter is a VHF or very high frequency transmitter, which sort of works like your car radio where you tune in a specific frequency and you can pick up the signal. Those allow for real-time tracking in the field with our specialized receiver and antennas. So in Louisiana, we mostly focus on using the remote style transmitter, although we do supplement it with some VHF for real-time tracking. And in the EMP, they've historically focused mostly on the VHF transmitter with some of the remote transmitters sprinkled in. Another difference you might see between the right and left photos here are the different colored leg bands. We in Louisiana use the colors on the right-hand side of the screen, and the EMP uses the left-hand side colors. So it's just an easy way if somebody sees a crane in the wild to sort of distinguish which flock that they came from.
So those VHF transmitters, we can pick up a signal with a handheld antenna, or we have a couple antennas on top of our vehicle that you can see there on the right. And we have an internship program in our department where in normal years we'll have interns on site, and they'll be learning different field data collection techniques. And they will monitor the parent-reared whooping cranes after they've been released pretty extensively. So For the first couple of weeks post-release, we will watch the birds pretty much all hours of the day, and then we'll kind of taper off until they migrate. Once we're sure that they're roosting in safe places, they're able to find food and are foraging in good areas, they're not interacting with things that might be unsafe or people or roads, that kind of thing. We would like to see them associating with the adult whooping cranes and just kind of tracking on where they're going and making sure that they're interacting with their landscape in a way that we would like to see. So once they migrate, they become the responsibility of some of our tracking volunteers. So we have a very dedicated crew of people throughout the flyway that some of which have tracking equipment or some just check areas where there historically have been whooping cranes during the winter, and they help us keep tabs on the cranes until they come back to Wisconsin. So we can't be in all these places at once, once the cranes scatter out during the winter. So we really are grateful to our volunteers who help us observe them throughout the winter as the juveniles gain more independence and hopefully are spending more and more time with other whooping cranes. Another way that we will get information about whooping cranes post-release, especially when they are scattered throughout the flyway, are reports from the general public. So if any of you see a whooping crane while you're out and about, you can let us know. We have a reporting site on our website where you can tell us if you saw a whooping crane, where you saw it, if you were able to see its leg bands, and any additional information or photos that you might have. If we get sightings for the Louisiana population, we'll also forward that information to Eva and her team down there.
But we also have a reporting site on the Department of Wildlife and Fisheries website as well.
So as you might remember in the beginning, I talked about how there were only a couple dozen whooping cranes in the wild. We have definitely made some progress since then. There are now over 800 whooping cranes in the world. So that includes our captive population. There's about 160 whooping cranes in captivity in our different facilities across North America. The wild population, the Aransas wood buffalo population, is now about 500 individuals that are migrating back and forth between Canada and Texas. And our reintroduced populations are between 70 and 85 birds each. This graphic was made at the end of 2019, so they're a little bit different than that now, but pretty similar in size. And there are still a few remnant birds in the Florida non-migratory population that spend the entire year in Central Florida. We've also learned a lot about just how to do whooping crane reintroductions and how whooping cranes interact with different types of landscapes and any other ways that we can help whooping cranes in the wild, whether that's in the reintroduced or in the wild populations.
So just some general update points on the Louisiana non-migratory population. This graph shows the cumulative total number of whooping cranes released per year. That's the black line, and then the blue bars show the estimated population size each year. So as we add more cranes, the population is increasing, which is expected, but also it's good because it shows that we don't have very high numbers of mortality. And as of September 2020, we have about 76 cranes in the population, three of which were wild, hatched, and reared. So we've obviously had some accomplishments in the Louisiana flock. We have successfully reintroduced a non-migratory population into the historic range of the whooping crane. It's not yet self-sustaining. That's a goal that we're still working towards. The cranes exhibit appropriate behaviors, pairing, nesting, laying eggs. Down here in particular, it's especially important for the pairs to get acclimated to a point with the farming activity, because we do have most of our pairs nest in active crawfish fields. And as you can see in that photo, there's a crawfish boat going by a bird on a nest, and the bird doesn't really care. We also have pairs that have shown the ability to raise chicks to independence in the wild, another very important aspect of a self-sustaining population. But we also have some challenges, and a couple of those are high rates of embryo death. So the eggs, the chicks and the eggs are dying before they reach full term. We're trying to figure out why that's happening by using a few different methods right now. We use fake data logging eggs in some of the nests that collect temperature, humidity, and rotational data movement. And any eggs that don't hatch, we collect samples from and send them to labs for some testing. Our second major issue down here in Louisiana is poaching of the birds, which is pretty hard to address in besides educational ways. So we've tried, we have billboards up around the state, and we've done print ads and radio spots. But the newer thing that we're starting to get into more is if there is a shooting case and the person is caught, we're really advocating for stronger sentencing of those people to try to deter people in the future.
In the eastern migratory population, this graph is similar to the one Eva just showed you. So the black line is the number cumulatively of whooping cranes that we have released into the wild. And then each bar is the population size in that year. The different colors here just show the different proportions of ways that cranes were reared. So the blue bars are the cranes that were part of the ultralight program. Since the ultralight program has ended, you can see there are fewer ultralight birds in the population proportionally now. But we have been doing more parent rearing. So the red parts of the bar, there's more parent reared birds in the population now. And there are also more wild hatch birds, the green parts of the bar. So that's really promising. That's the one that we want to see. We would like there to be even more wild hatched birds in the population. You'll notice that the overall population size has gone down the last couple of years, and that's mainly attributed to fewer numbers of released birds. So we haven't released captive reared birds into the population in the same way that we used to the last few years. That's been happening for a variety of reasons, but this year it's happening because COVID-19 has put some constraints on our captive centers in terms of rearing birds as well as transferring eggs and chicks for release. So we're hoping for more birds to release next year. The eastern migratory population has had some of the similar accomplishments that the Louisiana population has had. So we have had good adult survival. We have adult birds that are forming pair bonds. They're building nests in appropriate habitat. They're laying fertile eggs. In recent years, we've had more wild hatched chicks born in the population, and kind of the last piece of the puzzle for this population to reach that self-sustaining mark is to have those chicks live to be adults that are breeding themselves. So that's kind of the focus of most of our research projects at the moment, is looking at wild hatched chick survival and different factors that might be affecting that part of the population's success. So we're looking with some of our partners or graduate students or interns that are working on projects looking at different types of habitat that cranes use while they're nesting or while they're chick rearing, if there's different habitat management actions that we can take to make that habitat better for them. We're looking at behavioral cues that whooping cranes might learn as they're growing up, if they're raised either by costume or by adult whooping cranes, or maybe they were hatched in the wild, seeing if that might make them better at being parents. And also just if getting more parenting experience helps them keep their chicks alive a little bit longer. So with that, we will take any questions that you may have, and I would invite you also to check out both ICF's website as well as Louisiana Department of Wildlife and Fisheries Whooping Crane website that you can see on your screen here. We also both have active Facebook pages. So if you're on Facebook, you can find some more kind of real-time updates on the populations there as well.
Thank you, Hillary. Another great webinar. This is Ann Lacey from the North America Programs at the International Crane Foundation, joining you again to throw some great questions that you have at our panelists. And today I am joined by Sarah Zamorski down in Louisiana. She is also with the Louisiana Department of Wildlife and Fisheries. Hi, Sarah.
Hi, Ann. Hi, everybody.
Go ahead and take some of those great questions and throw them out there for them.
Good. There's been a lot of good questions. I've been trying to keep up. One that we sort of got a couple different versions of. Eva, folks wanted to know how the Louisiana cranes did through the recent hurricanes and how the release pens, which you showed a photo of, did the hurricane.
Right. The cranes, as far as we know, all did well. There's only about eight that we haven't been able to visually confirm, but that's mostly because they're in more remote locations that we can't really access. But everybody else has been seen and is fine. Based on the data from remote transmitters, it looks like they just hunkered down where they were and kind of rode it out. In terms of the release pens, the one at White Lake is totally fine. Maybe just a few little patches need to be done to reconnect some fencing. Unfortunately, the one at Rockefeller, which is the one that I showed a picture of, was destroyed. We don't have any pictures, so we don't know the extent, but we heard that it's pretty bad. They got some storm surge and some high winds down there, so.
All right.
Thank you, Eva. A lot of people had questions about vaccines and the vaccination of the cranes. Marianne, I wonder if you could talk a little bit about that. Quite a few about when they're vaccinated, for what, and are the captive birds also vaccinated for various things?
Yes, so the cranes are vaccinated on the adult cranes are vaccinated on an annual basis for equine encephalitis as well as for West Nile virus. Because there have been instances where we have seen that whooping cranes and sandhill cranes are susceptible to those. So for the chicks, they often get their, if I could remember right, they get their vaccines when they're about a month and a half old, and then they'll get it again, usually when they're around fledging age or right before we send them off for reintroduction.
Great. Thank you.
Another one that a couple people asked about was how the ongoing coronavirus pandemic has impacted everybody's work this year. So maybe we could get each of you to answer that. Hillary, do you want to start? And then it's probably similar, but maybe Hillary and then Eva and Marianne.
So we at the Crane Foundation have been impacted in a variety of ways, but my program in particular, you know, most of what we do is going outside and looking at birds in the field. So thankfully we've been able to do some of that. We've all, you know, adapted in different ways, wearing masks, driving our own cars, that kind of thing. But we have still been able to do some of our normal field work this year. In the beginning of the year, when everything was kind of on lockdown, we were just sort of waiting and hoping that the cranes were nesting successfully, and we just didn't know about it. But thankfully, we were able to do some field work still during nesting season, and we deployed some remote cameras that helped us keep tabs on the population from afar. We do use some of the remote transmitters like Eva talked about, so we were able to watch them kind of come back from migration. Our internship program has been impacted as well, like I mentioned. So right now we have one intern who has been doing lots of field work, so we're very appreciative for all of her help and kind of adapting to the situation as we go. So kind of same boat as a lot of folks out there, I'm sure, are finding new norms and new ways to try to do some of the things that we would normally do.
Here in Louisiana, it's pretty much the same. We were still able to do a lot of the field work that we would normally do. It did impact our ability to pull any eggs from nesting pairs in order to give data logging eggs to some of those. So our sample size this year with the fake data logging eggs is very low. So really it just mostly impacted our ability to do any egg transfers that maybe we would do in a normal year.
And for us, also at ICF. And during the major lockdown, we went down to a very small skeletal crew, and we ended up rotating through who was here so that in case somebody got sick, it wouldn't wipe out the entire CCD, the Crane Conservation Department, people taking care of the cranes that are here on site. Once things relaxed a little bit, we're all working back now as one group, but it did impact our captive propagation program, as well as our intern program. And so for chick rearing, basically we closed down the chick rearing program this year. It's hard to get fertile eggs if you're doing artificial insemination. You need to be closer than 6 feet. And so basically our production this year was closed down. Now we're working pretty close to normal, also wearing masks and gloves and taking extra care that we're working a little bit more independently than what we did before, but still as a team and adjusting well.
Thanks, everybody. It certainly has been a challenge, but luckily the cranes have kept on. A question for, I think, for Hillary and Eva. Can you each kind of talk about what issues predation has, what the effects are for each of your populations that you monitor?
Sure. So for the eastern migratory population, I think predation is still our number one cause of death for cranes, but not that we want to see predation, but predation is a normal part of life in the wild. So that's, you know, kind of what we would expect to see is that that would be the number one cause of mortality. So some of the other types of mortality that are more human caused are the things that we try to reduce as much as possible. So that includes poaching, like Eva mentioned, might include power line collisions or some like vehicle collisions or any kind of other mortalities that might be caused by humans. So those are kind of the ones that wouldn't be as normal in the wild. Predation, we think, is part of what is causing chick mortality, but it's pretty hard to tell why chicks die because they're so small, they're hard to see. Sometimes they just disappear and it's hard to know what happened to them. You don't often find any evidence of what happened. So we're still kind of tracking on that for chick survival, trying to figure out what some of the predators are. But for adults, they're pretty, I mean, whooping cranes are big and they're kind of mean. So they're good at defending themselves against predators. They'll take on things that I would be afraid to take on. So they're pretty feisty.
Yeah, same in Louisiana. Predation is just a normal part of life in the wild, like Hillary said. And really, the bigger concerns are the more human-caused deaths. And actually, of the ones that we can determine a cause of death in Louisiana, which is about half of our overall deaths, the two leading causes are poaching and power line collisions. So predation falls to number three in this case. We don't know what the cause of death for every crane is just because it's really hot down here. And if a crane dies, the remains get degraded so quickly that the health lab can't really determine why the crane died. But as far as we know, for the ones that we do have a cause of death for, it's really power line collisions and poaching.
And I've got even another question for you. Folks wanted to know about the cranes that are on private land, how the crawfish farmers are feel about the cranes being on their property.
Most of the crawfish farmers really are okay with them being around. We haven't had any really upset landowners. We have had some that would prefer that they're not there, but We haven't run into any major issues. The landowners have all really been friendly and allow us to access the property when we need it. And we're really grateful for their cooperation.
Marianne, I have a question for you that Eva can tie into as well. Someone had asked, why aren't all cranes raised by real cranes in captivity, so why aren't they all parent reared? But also, you know, are they then accepted by the wild population? So Hillary and Eva can speak to this, when you might release a bird that has been parent reared in the company of wild birds, are they accepted?
Well, earlier on, parent rearing releases were not doing well. And so the best way to get birds out on the landscape was by using a costume and the ultralight aspect. So that's part of why. Also, in order to do releases and start a population, you need a large number. And generally speaking, cranes basically lay two eggs. And if they lay two eggs, you would need to have, and only one of them survives, you would need to have 20 pairs, 30 pairs that are all producing and doing well, raising the crane chicks. So it's just more cost effective if we could have the pairs. We could recycle the pairs, get more eggs from them. And then when we do that, we can get 4 to 6 eggs from each pair, hopefully increasing our production. And that way we can, you know, what do we do with those eggs? So the costumes come into play in order to raise those eggs. And then the last clutch, the pair ends up raising one chick. And so then we can have more parent reared birds on the landscape.
I'll go first. So in Louisiana, we actually don't have that many parent reared birds that we've released so far. I think only 3 really in the methods that Hillary had described earlier. And the 2 that we released first in 2016 or early 2017, have now integrated into the flock, or the one that survived has been integrated into the flock and actually nested this year. The last one we released in early 2019 sort of is doing his own thing, and he has interacted with other whooping cranes, but now has pretty much been on his own for a while, although he knows where the other cranes are.
Yeah, I would say it's pretty similar in the eastern migratory population. So there are some young birds that kind of do their own thing or maybe hang out with sandhills, but I think that's pretty normal. I don't think that's anything to do with whether or not they were parent reared or custom reared. I think if they're young, they just are kind of moving around doing their own thing. And some of them are more inclined to hang out with other whooping cranes than others. We have released parent reared chicks either by themselves near adult cranes or in pairs. And so sometimes if we release them in pairs, sometimes the two will stick together, sometimes they'll split up. Sometimes the chicks will hang out with the adults, sometimes they'll move somewhere else, sometimes they'll find other adults on their migration. So they do seem to find other whooping cranes. They know they're a whooping crane, they've seen other whooping cranes. So they don't always hang out with the adults, but it seems like as they get older and they're more motivated to find a pair or find a mate and start nesting, they are totally assimilated into the population. So. Yeah.
Sarah, do you have any more questions? I have a couple.
You can go ahead. I'll scroll through and see if I can find some more, but go ahead, Anne.
There's a lot of poaching questions that have come up, and I don't know if you guys want to address that. I know that on our website we have lots of information for people if they want to go and look at that there. More than you guys want to deal with, but there was a lot of questions about releases in Wisconsin, Hillary, about where currently releases are being directed.
Sure. So I guess in terms of the poaching question, we do have a team at ICF that is dedicated to doing outreach about whooping cranes in areas where there are whooping cranes. So if you live in an area where there are whooping cranes nearby, you may have seen them doing some events or some types of outreach or advertising just to make sure that people know about whooping cranes. And like Eva mentioned earlier, they also are advocating for stronger penalties for people who do get caught poaching, so that we try to kind of increase awareness and excitement about whooping cranes where there are whooping cranes, and then also increase the fines and penalties for people who poach so that they kind of are less motivated to do so. So it's not my area of expertise, but it is something that ICF has been very dedicated to, and I know Louisiana has as well. In terms of release in Wisconsin, the original release area for this population was at Nisida National Wildlife Refuge in central Wisconsin, and that is where the core breeding area for the population is. So we do still have a lot of whooping cranes that breed at Nisida and spend their time there, hatch their chicks there and things. So there are a lot of cranes there still, but we haven't done releases at Nisida in a few years because we have identified that black flies were a problem there and were causing cranes to abandon their nests. So in 2011, we started releasing whooping cranes into eastern Wisconsin in areas where there were fewer black flies so that eventually they would establish territories and nest there and wouldn't be as affected by the black flies. So we are continuing to release birds into the eastern migratory population in the eastern part of Wisconsin. So the core areas there are Horicon National Wildlife Refuge, as well as White River Marsh State Wildlife Area. So there are some groups of whooping cranes over in that area as well, and they have started nesting there. We had our first chick fledge in the eastern part of the state this year over at Horicon National Wildlife Refuge, so that was really exciting. The pair over there was one of the costume-reared birds that Marianne raised at Horicon Marsh, and its mate was a parent-reared bird that we released at Horicon Marsh a few years ago. So that was really a nice thing to see this year. One of the things that has made me smile in kind of a tough year has been watching that family group learn to use the marsh and really using a lot of the same places that Marianne was using when she was teaching the costume-reared cranes how to find food and things in the marsh at Horicon. So that's really been exciting. And we, are still working to release cranes in Wisconsin. Like I said, no releases this year, but hopefully next year we'll have some.
One other question that folks might be interested in, maybe Eva first and then Hillary, they were wondering for the eggs and the chicks that aren't surviving, if there's been any testing done for insecticides or herbicides that might drift into the wetlands from neighboring habitats or agriculture or something like that. So they mentioned that they know cranes in Wisconsin eat corn and assume that birds in Louisiana probably eat seeds or grain of some sort as well.
Yeah, so in Louisiana, the samples that we take from the eggs get tested a general toxicology test and for herbicides. So far, we haven't had any red flags coming back from those tests.
In Wisconsin, we haven't tested eggs, mostly because the eggs typically do hatch, and if they don't, they are predated or something, and we don't have them. And then as far as testing chicks, we have done a little bit of that. There was a team up at Nisida that were monitoring wild hatch chicks throughout the year to try to determine what were the causes of mortality. So they were out every single day, I think twice a day, following these chicks, trying to do their best to recover the carcasses when they would find them. And like I mentioned before, it's pretty hard to find them. And it's also warm in the summer and things degrade quickly or sometimes get scavenged and there's not really enough left to tell what happened. But I know they did some preliminary testing for those types of things in the chicks that they were able to recover. And I don't remember if they found anything that was of concern, but I don't think that there was any widespread or major concerns that we've, you know, had to address. So I think it's still a question that's out there that, you know, we'll continue to keep our eyes open for, but right now haven't had any really big red flags about it.
Good news. I think we will wrap up with one last question, maybe the most important question for each of you. How can folks support each of our programs for whooping cranes?
Sure. So I think the biggest thing is that ICF is a member-based organization. We do rely on donations from people. So you can always become a member or donate to the Crane Foundation. If you would like to donate specifically to some of our programs, you can put that in the notes on your donation that you'd like to support maybe whooping crane reintroductions or maybe the team who takes care of the birds in captivity. You can sponsor their programs as well. You can, when you become a member, you also are subscribed to our newsletter. You get different kind of perks from being a member that you can find out more about what's happening with the cranes in the wild or the cranes at ICF. So I think that's one great way that everybody can help. And then I think in addition to that, you can be excited about whooping cranes. You can tell your friends and family about what maybe something you learned today, or maybe if you've seen one in your area or somewhere else in the past, or if you do in the future, you'll see it and now you'll know that's a whooping crane, and you can tell your friends and family about the plight of the whooping cranes or how, you know, all these interesting ways that whooping cranes get into the wild, all that goes into raising and releasing them. So those are some ways that you can kind of help spread the word about whooping cranes and help people get excited about work that we're doing and trying to keep growing these populations in the wild. Eva, did you have anything to add from the Louisiana side?
Pretty much all the same stuff. We have a Louisiana Wildlife and Fisheries Foundation if people wish to donate money, but also just spreading the word, letting people know about cranes, maybe sharing Facebook posts. Those things also are very helpful.
You can go to the next slide, Marianne. So again, we'd just like to say another thank you to today's webinar sponsor. Like I mentioned, there was an anonymous sponsor who would like to dedicate this to Kate Mars, a longtime friend and supporter of the International Crane Foundation, and we are very grateful to their sponsorship. And if you'd like to learn more about sponsoring one of the future webinars, you can contact Kate Fitzwilliams at the Crane Foundation, and she will give you some more information. Please feel free to join us next week for our next From the Field webinar, which is about creating conservation leaders at the International Crane Foundation. We create conservation leaders in all types of interesting ways, so you can tune in and listen to our Whooping Crane Outreach Coordinator, Lizzie Condon, our Education Program Coordinator, Ben Lamb, as well as our President and CEO, Rich Belfast, talk about our next generation of conservation leaders. And thanks also to the anonymous sponsor for that webinar, who is glad to help the International Crane Foundation in any way. We appreciate that. So that is next week, Thursday, October 1st at 11 a.m. Central Time. And again, this presentation and much of the work that you heard us talk about today is made possible by the support of people like you. So we really thank you for your time, for tuning in, for being members and donating to the Crane Foundation. Thanks. And like I said, you can catch this online later as well.